The learning objectives of this chapter are that you will be aware of the potential health hazards when dealing with marine fuels, know the preventative measures that should be taken to minimise the risk from these hazards, and be aware of the first aid measures necessary to deal with victims of these hazards. As we have seen, the liquid fuels for marine use are a complex mixture of hydrocarbon compounds, which can include a number of contaminant elements. This means that actual composition of the fuels will vary greatly, depending on the source of the original crude oil and also the refining processes used in the production of the fuel. There are a number of health hazards which may be present when dealing with the fuel, either through direct skin contact, exposure to vapours, or through swallowing the liquid. These are in addition to the obvious fire and explosion risks, which may be considered as indirect health hazards. The products of combustion, and in particular the products of incomplete combustion, also constitute a health hazard, but are outside the scope of this module. In this chapter, we will look at the direct health hazards and the means of reducing the associated risk to you. We will also consider the first aid that should be given in the event of skin contact, inhalation, or ingestion. There are a number of onboard tasks which have potential risk of skin contact that you are likely to be involved with. These would include, but not be restricted to, bunkering operations, including sounding and sampling, maintenance of fuel-related equipment, including purifiers, filters, and engine fuel system components, and cleaning and inspection of fuel tanks. The above tasks are covered in detail either in the module Marine Fuel Handling and Pre-Treatment or Marine Fuel Systems. They are mentioned here only as examples of where risks might occur. There is evidence to show that prolonged contact with fuel oil, either distillate or residual, can result in skin irritation or dermatitis, or in some cases, skin cancer. This risk is associated with the presence of particular aromatic compounds, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which result from the various cracking processes used in refining. There is a risk of skin penetration and possible blood poisoning when carrying out fuel injector testing if the spray is directed onto the body. With residual fuels, you should also be aware that there is often a risk of scalding due to the high temperatures required for pre-treatment and preparation. As an engineer aboard ship, you cannot avoid having to deal with fuel. It is therefore your own responsibility to ensure that you take all necessary precautions to minimise the risk to yourself and others. Take particular care to avoid exposure to high-pressure sprays when testing fuel injectors. Remember, you should always make yourself familiar with the safety data sheet for any materials that you have to deal with before you deal with them. You should also use suitable personal protection equipment when handling fuel or fuel-related equipment. This should include boiler suit, oil-resistant rubber gloves, and safety goggles. If you have sensitive skin, then you should also use a good barrier cream. You should never use distillate fuels to clean your hands or personal protection equipment. It is obviously good practice to keep your hands clean by washing them as soon as you finish any dirty task on board ship. In the event of contact with fuel oil, you should immediately remove any contaminated clothing and thoroughly wash the skin with soap and water. Clothes and shoes should be thoroughly washed before reuse. In the event of any skin irritation occurring, then you will need to seek medical advice. Remember, you should avoid unnecessary prolonged or repeated skin contact with fuel if you wish to minimize the risk. Fuel oil may enter the eye during normal cleaning and maintenance operations due to spillage, spray, or rubbing your eyes with oil-covered hands. There are no significant health hazards linked to this, although irritation of the eye may result from fuel entry. Any high-pressure spray directed onto the eye may cause physical damage. Whenever you are dealing with fuel oil and fuel-related equipment, you should wear suitable safety goggles that offer full protection to the eyes. Avoid hand contact with the eyes when fuel is present. In the event of fuel oil entering the eye should be washed out with plenty of clean water and a suitable eye wash. Eyewash stations should be available in any areas where testing or cleaning of fuel equipment is likely. Although unlikely, accidental ingestion may occur when dealing with leakages or large spills, which result in fuel oil spraying into the air. It could also occur if a victim accidentally drinks liquid fuel oil that is stored in an unsuitable container. If fuel oil is swallowed, it may result in a stomach upset or diarrhea. Although this is obviously inconvenient, it is not considered to be serious. What may be considered a serious indirect risk, however, is that in the event of vomiting following ingestion, fuel may be aspirated into the lungs. You can think of aspiration in this case as breathing in the liquid fuel. This could lead to life-threatening lung damage, such as chemically induced pneumonia. If you are involved with dealing with a fuel spillage or cleaning of a fuel tank, then you should take all precautions to minimize the risk of fuel ingestion. These will include a face mask, which covers and protects the mouth. Never, for any reason, drink fuel oil or any unknown fluid from a drinking container. Remember, never use drinking containers, old bottles or similar, for storing fuel oils. Any small containers used for fuel oils should be clearly marked so that mistakes are not made. If the partial ingestion of fuel is limited to contamination of the mouth, then the victim should rinse the mouth thoroughly with plenty of clean water. If, however, the fuel oil is swallowed, then no attempt should be made to induce vomiting, as this may lead to aspiration of the fuel oil and major health risk. Medical assistance should be sought with some urgency. It is necessary to provide full information on the product to the medical staff treating the victim. The greatest inhalation risk is not directly from the liquid fuels, but from the gases and vapors that may be released during storage and use. The risk of gas and vapor release is increased as temperatures increase. With residual fuels in particular, highly toxic hydrogen sulfide gas may be present, and this constitutes a major hazard. Inhalation of the gases and vapors may result in breathing difficulties and drowsiness, with the risk of the victim losing consciousness. In extreme circumstances, where concentrations of the gases and vapors are high, a fatality may result. The best method of minimizing the risk due to inhalation is to maintain good ventilation wherever fuel oil is present, and in particular when heating the oil. If operations require entry into a fuel tank, then this should be treated as any other enclosed space, and the relevant procedures should be adhered to. These will include risk assessment, ISM requirements, permit to work. The tank should be thoroughly ventilated to ensure an oxygen content of at least 20%, and hydrocarbon gas concentration less than 1% of the lower flammable limit. Normal rescue preparations must be maintained, with sufficient personnel and breathing apparatus available. In the event that the atmosphere cannot be brought within the limits stated above, and tank entry is essential, then breathing apparatus must be worn. In cases where exposure to hydrogen sulfide gas is possible, then a suitably certified air-supplied respirator working on positive pressure must be worn. If entry into a badly ventilated fuel tank is not absolutely necessary, then you should not enter at all. In the event that irritation to the nose and mouth or dizziness or breathing difficulty is experienced, then the victim should be taken to an area where fresh air is present. If breathing has stopped, then artificial respiration should be applied and the victim given oxygen to aid recovery. Medical advice should be sought.